Welcome to the second panel of today's May Day School program, titled Religion, Patriarchy and Misogyny. With me there are two panelists, Andrea Jovanovic and Juan Isnanovic, who will present their contributions on this very broad and interesting topic. At the beginning, I will present a short description of the panel because as we can see, the three very big topics are in need of some narrow focus to discuss some problematic views that occur inside this discussion area, and also address some more topical issues that have arisen in the past years in connection with those three topics, because of course already a lot has been said in relationship with religion, patriarchy. A lot has been written already the past years and has been thoroughly analyzed, so therefore there is a need of a more narrow view on the matter. So the most pressing contemporary conflicts regarding the social role of religion in Europe are obviously those related to Islamic minorities and their integration. Unlike the right, the left is struggling to find the clear answers, wavering between unity on a strictly secular basis and multicultural cohabitation. On the other hand, the left often perceives religion as inherently backwards, especially when it comes to gender roles, or the question of gender roles, that is, the frequent reproduction of misogyny and tendency to re-traditionalization that occurs in the religious communities. The panel will try to find a way how to address the role of gender and its consequences in relation to the dominant secularist reception of any sort of religious practice, with the emphasis on Western notions about freedom and gender inequality in relation to Islam and Orthodox Church, since those two religious practices are common also in the ex-Yugoslavia region. The panel will try to analyze what are the potential negative outcomes of the left perspectives when they insist only on the secularist point of view while overlooking other factors that maintain seemingly religiously motivated misogyny. So with me, as already said, is Andrea Jovanovic and Juan Isnanovic. I will just introduce them shortly. Andrea Jovanovic is a master student of the Faculty of Media and Communications in Belgrade. Her theoretical interests cover the critique of political economy, Marxist feminism, and theories of labor in capitalism. She's also a member of the Gerusia Collective, which is stationed in Novi Sad and Belgrade. And Juan Isnanovic works for Radio Student, writing social and political commentaries as well as literary criticism. And he's also an editor in the literary journal Idiot, and in 2012 he won the Best Debut of the Year, awarded by the Slovene Writers Association for his poetry. He was also chosen to be the critic for the Critics Festival Pranger in 2016 and 17, and he presented his analysis of cultural and artistic phenomena at various discussions and roundtables, for example, at the Literodrom Festival, the Week of Slovenian Drama, and an intervention at the Academy of Fine Arts. So without further ado, I would ask Andrea to start with her contribution titled Woman in Orthodox Serbia Between Practices and Beliefs. And before we start, there will be a list going around where you can please sign your participation. And Andrea, the floor is yours.
Okay, first I of course have to do these formal things. I have to thank to the Institut za Dalarske Studije. I'm very happy to be in Ljubljana again, and I'm always happy to be here. And especially Clara for preparing this with us and doing all those works. So, firstly, because I suppose that some of you actually don't come from this region and are not particularly familiar with what happened during Yugoslavia, socialist Yugoslavia period towards religion questions, I have to give some context, and then I will go into more detail what happened after the dissolution of Yugoslavia and in Serbia during the 90s, so we can understand that chronological context and how, where do we stand today before I actually start talking about what I want to talk. So I didn't do much research, well, certainly not enough research on religious questions in Yugoslavia, and but basically it was nominally and almost in many ways practically a secular country where church and yeah, you should also have you should also have in mind that Yugoslavia was a multicultural country where you had different religions, not only Orthodox Christianity, but you also have Catholic religion and Muslim and even some minority religions. So but it was nominally secular country, and church, especially Serbian church back then, had, like Domagoj said today, a role of keeping the cultural legacy and perhaps even national legacies, and to do that kind of a work. But it should be said that church didn't have explicitly or even implicitly political power. And when the end of Yugoslavia came, in the 90s, Orthodox Church, but the process began already in the 80s, during the 80s, but the Orthodox Serbian Church was actually given a really huge political role, especially during the wartime. And it had this aggressive pro-war stand, and between these politics and the re-traditionalization of the whole society, and of course the nationalism that was one of the biggest issues back then, it also had different things to say about women's role in society. And perhaps it is actually during the 90s, it was the point where different feminist organizations that started existing back then, and Orthodox Serbian Church actually met, and women question had actually, so-called women question had actually a quite important role during the 90s. So that is some kind of a context that we should have in mind while I continue talking about these things. So first thing that I would say, and it's a methodological thing, that when we're talking about women in Serbian Orthodox space, we have to not mix up two different things. The first is the level of religious theory or religious beliefs, or even really propositions that are being prescribed by religious institutions and religious practices in these institutions, from the ordinary everyday practices of religious people. Those are two different things, and we have to take them as different. And in those things, I will first talk about this, and this, I will give it just a little time about this first level. So when you're looking about when you look at the formal or practices and theories and beliefs in religious institutions, you have to see that during 90s, and it actually lasts until today, it was a very harsh stand towards so-called women question, and they had very harsh reproductive rights politics. So although abortion was completely legal, and in Serbia that abortion law didn't change since 72nd year when it was firstly legalized in Yugoslavia, and it is still legal in Serbia, during 90s it started through anti-abortion speeches, and that were coming from the very top people from the church. Also, it was a very strong advocacy for maternity and the figure of women only as mother, and what is equally important, the Serbian mother, and because it was a wartime, you actually had, I will just give one example how it looked back then, and it looked very terrifying when you're looking for these tents, when we had like a lot of mothers losing their children, and our top priests back then were saying that if a mother lost her only son, it's her fault because she didn't have more children. So yeah, that's how they actually in the media were advocating this policy. And it is important to understand that it was not the only church thing. Perhaps you can even say that during Yugoslavia you could find those. I'm sorry, I have to be informal, crazy priests talking like this, but they wouldn't given enough space in public to do this as official state politics. But during the 90s, they had like a really lot of space. It was very used in this populist right-wing manner, and it had some influence. And then, so that's why I want to and I will just mention, so I go back to this, that when you look at religious institutions and women in religious institutions like nuns, they actually are very low at this hierarchy, and the jobs that they are actually providing in churches and other religious institutions are almost the same as they do in many family or the rest of the society. They do reproductive work, but not, of course, being mothers, but taking care of the lunch, washing dishes, doing at the fields and so on, and they are not actually having the right to talk directly to God. Only priests could do that, so it's like a big differentiation of women's job at church and men's job at church. So, but aside of this, when we look back at what was I talking before this, is that although the very broad space was given during the 90s and perhaps is still being given, but I would say with any hesitation, it has not even close to the same effect as it did in the 90s to this kind of a religious politics. Even during the 90s, we have to differentiate this level, the level of ordinary people and how they actually, religious people, and how they looked to this how to say, religious norms or whatever. And when we look at this, it is not so simple. And when I started researching for this paper, not only this paper, this is something that has a little bit to do with my MA thesis, is that when we look what academy and sociologists and philosophers provide when they try to analyze this, they would actually do some kind of a discourse analysis or something like that, and only looking to what churchmen were saying, as if what they were saying was completely reflected on society, and like there was no difference between these two things. So when they are criticizing church, they are also by criticizing church, they would tend to criticize religious people, and that is where some of the contradictions and some of the conflicts that are still existing in Serbia societies came from. So I try to make this difference between these two levels, and to actually see how the practice of and common beliefs of these religious people actually work beyond this what church is actually prescribing. So when you look at that, you can firstly see that it's not only a religious things, it is intertwined with many different social factors and different determinants and so on. So I made it as like two different positions, so just we could more, so I could more easily talk, and so you could more easily follow up. But the first one is so-called anti-church positions, and the second one is pro-church positions. And I will analyze all of them, sometimes with a reflection of how did in Yugoslavia these things being sold. So some of you who were here 2 years ago and perhaps listened to my previous lecture, I was talking about Anti-Fascist Front of Women in Yugoslavia, and it was an organization that started working during, even before the Second World War, but it officially started working during it. And it was a very interesting example to look how socialists tried, socialist women tried to do it, women questions, and how today we actually never look back and never try to perhaps even learn something from that. So I will include in some parts of this father's speech what did they do when they come to the similar issues that we are dealing today. So first, when we're talking about anti-church position, you have to see that during Yugoslavia and during AFW, Anti-Fascist Front of Women actually was working. It was a very conservative society, especially in Serbia, and right now I have to talk only about Serbia so we can make a better focus, yeah, and comparisons. And what they were doing there, what the problems were back then was, of course, the north part of Yugoslavia, which was under pre-Yugoslavia time, under Habsburg or Austria government, they have like more being. It was easier for AFW to work with those women, especially because some of them were actually coming from the higher classes and they even had rights for education and so on. But when the more south you go, the bigger issues, of course, would emerge. And especially at Kosovo, it was, of course, the most problematic part during the 50s. When they tried to introduce women equality. So what they were doing, and it was completely different from what women organizations today are doing when they're trying to deal with the same problems, is that they wouldn't go back there and say like, okay, now we have different politics and you must do as we say, or even do some culture racist assessments about those kind of areas and those kind of women. So what they actually do, they tried to understand that tradition and they tried to use that tradition for the emancipatory process. So you have many different examples of this. One of the perhaps funniest one is that many of what was later been looked at partisan songs were actually ethno songs that were old, like for 5,000 years or 100 years or 300 years, that were actually part of those areas in Serbian ethno-cultural traditions, and they were very familiar with women living there. Especially, you even have some literary studies that are actually trying to prove that many of these songs were actually written or sang by firstly women, because they had children and they put them to sleep with them and so on. So what they tried, they actually used these songs and just changed some lyrics a bit and tried to talk them through to this. This is, of course, only one example, and I cannot say with certainty how what was the reach of this approach, but especially because Anti-Fascist Front of Women dissolved very soon after that. Perhaps if they were given more time, it would have a better result. But it was just what we need to see here. It was a completely different stance towards what we have today by so-called liberal feminists trying to hold all this tradition and to see this tradition as whole, as backwards one, okay? So, sorry, I didn't write the paper and I always forget some words. So, they actually tried to respect that tradition, but to change it with communication with those areas. And they also tried to look and to find traditional practices that women used to and to traditionally traditional to suprotstaviti se, to oppose these politics, and it was something that was oftenly been learned from mother to daughter and so on, and it was not publicly known. It was inside of women's circles, and it was all a family or a village thing. So they tried to understand what these practices were and how they helped women, because when you didn't have abortion laws during pre-war Yugoslavia, you did, they still did have abortions using different herbs and so on and so on. So they tried to see how did they manage their everyday life and how they opposed these religious views, and to use that as the standpoint for just improve that similar politics. So in 90s, now I go 40 years ahead, during 90s the feminist approaches were completely different. Of course there was a wartime, but we have this emerge of NGO feminism actually, and some of those and probably the most public one, NGOs were financed by different Western institutions, and they of course and partly because of these finances have to have this top-down approach where they tried to simply introduce feminist politics that were Western politics and Western understanding of what feminism is. And I'm sorry for simplifying, I understand that there are even differences inside the Western approaches, but for this use we can continue. So and when they tried to oppose church, because church was doing what it was doing, as I described earlier, so they actually go publicly and try to do with all these public speeches and norms and whatever the church was prescribing, but never looking to how ordinary people actually was receiving this and whether they were receiving this at all. So now I will just say one thing. I talked with some women. I didn't do any serious sociological research. I don't know how to do that. I'm unfortunately a philosopher, not a sociologist, but I did talk to different women from different ages, and of course my mother, and how do they look at these, I actually tried to read her, like when one of the most famous people from Serbian Orthodox Church, Patriarch Pavle, what was he saying about women when they have period, they shouldn't enter the church and so on. And I was like, did you know he was saying this? Like, why do you love him? What? And she was like, I never heard of it. I don't care of it, because his public figure didn't actually have to do with all those anti-women speeches that were not that visible or actually didn't have many effect. But he was seen as a humble old guy who is a spiritual and a nice person, and who is and what is more important, he was actually humble. He was always criticizing the rich priests, and it was something that was communicating with the lower classes in Serbia. So and that's how he was seen by many women, not just my mother, by many different women that I actually talked about this. So that's one of the things that we have to have in mind. So the consequences of these 19th politics and the feminist politics and the stance towards different religions, religious women-related questions, is that because they had this this Western agenda, it was often used both by liberal side, liberal feminist both, and at the same time by the right-wing populists, whether it was politicians or intellectuals or even church personality, if I can say that, was that it is that what feminists are doing were Western agenda, and it is something that is being brought from the West. So. By doing so, a very interesting consequence is that they were actually deleting erasing from the memory, trying to erase from the memory all those sides of the conflict. The fact that the Yugoslavia was already secular, mm-hmm. and you didn't have to have these liberal NGOs to come there and introduce us with feminism or whatever. When you look at any law of during Yugoslavia period, not only religious, connected to religion and church, but many different Yugoslavia, at least at formal level, was trying to have the gender equality, and much more than some of our countries today. So, so it is one of the important discontinuity, let's say, that this that secularity and this critique of really of this of course backwards stance towards women that were coming from church mustn't only be Western agenda. It could they just fail to somehow connect it to what was not many years ago our own history. So the second consequence is that that is because of this harsh liberal propaganda, anti-church propaganda that was coming from these NGOs, and I'm not saying that it was their purpose or either that they were doing it consciously. They actually did very important job with anti-war propaganda, but because of the way and manners they were doing it, and that were sometimes subjectively, but sometimes objectively restrained because of the Western finance, because of the broader political situation and so on. You have this very strong anti-feminist NGO stance among common women in Serbia, and it lasts even today. So it is one of the bad consequences of these politics. Now I will go to pro-church position and try to see what can we say about this? So, what I want to do is perhaps provide how we can still be critical of these obviously backward positions the church sometimes has, or almost always has, but still not respect, but try to connect and understand and transform. Without being outsider of these practices. So, and I will use, I just started actually reading Gramsci a few months ago, and he has this brilliant thing when he talks about that what we should do in our ideological battles for ideological I can say it in English. Okay, that we should try to find bond sense in common sense, which means that so-called common sense always is a mix of many different views, and that we shouldn't just try to erase it or to negate it, but to work within it to find what is bond in that common. Bond is good, and I will try to do this here. Firstly, there are some more abstract things. First is that although church has this stance, not only about women question, of course church is by definition a conservative part of the society, at least the Western part of the world, but they also do have, because of the beliefs and many other things, it is a way that it is a traditionally communal way of life that is often present inside areas of society that are religious. So the idea of communal life, the idea of solidarity, the idea of helping each other, and so on, many different things that we would perhaps today describe communism, is actually present in not only in theory but also in many different practices. And the second thing is that even if you look by theory and not only by what famous priests are saying, many of the religious views can be used in fighting for equality, humanitarianism, and so on. So, and that is, of course, what some of the South America countries were doing. So, but in 2000s, if that's the way we say it, we of course have in Serbia introduction of so-called neoliberalism or neoliberalist capitalism, and things change a bit. Of course, they change on many different levels, which I really don't want to talk now, and I guess you all know what that means. But when we see this in the context of religious stance, we can see that, for example, by the huge rise of unemployment and by women's very bad position and the labor markets, where they, if they can get a job, they usually can get the very bad jobs and very low paid jobs. That how that communicate with the church still dominant stance that women should stay in the house and not go and work and be mothers and housewives and so on, that many of the women in poor parts of the society are actually understanding this church as comfort, or as if it is understanding their bad position and would gladly actually stay in the house than go to these harsh markets and so on. So it is some, it has a communication. We shouldn't just look at it as some formal law or some formal abstract right women to work. We should just try to understand what does it mean for women in Serbia today to be working. So, and the other thing, and this is something I actually not a while ago find out about it, is the many different services, even communal services, that the church is providing for women. And one of them is, as I said a moment ago, but a little bit different, is comfort, because they have like going for the advice from the local priest, or just talking about your problems and not having medical help or psychological help or anything like that, but the priest becomes almost a psychoanalysis. So you can have that, and it is also a place where women meet, especially in the rural parts of the Serbia, because you don't have cultural centers anymore, you don't have cinema, you don't have those things that we did have during Yugoslavia, and church almost became the only part of the community where people can meet, and of course where women can meet and change their different stance and so on. But I must say that even this is a little bit, it's not just like that, because it mostly is like that when you talk about middle or older generations of women. When we talk about younger generations of women, I would need to give a whole new lecture about it, but it is completely different. I've heard just a while ago that many of the women monasteries in Serbia are actually lacking of women, and like the youngest women right now are having 60 and more 60 or more years, and so they are actually, we have very old women monasteries, so you can see that there has been some generational leap or change. But and you, we have to understand that these women that are not 60 or more years old were women who were growing up during Yugoslavia period and not during 90s period. So it is also one of the signifiers that things shouldn't be understand this banal manner, like church was strong and so the people did consume everything it provided. It's simply not true, even empirically. And the other thing is that church is providing something very interesting. It is providing alternative medicine, but it is not like you go to the priest and he prays for you. It is actually alternative medicine in the terms of different herbs and different homemade cures that are actually the state is giving for that. It is being controlled by the state. It is not something illegal, that's what I wanted to say. But still, many of the monasteries and the churches even are selling this at not very big prices. So when so you have many women, and the cancer issue is really huge in Serbia right now, that go that they go there to seek for help, and it is of course not It is not determined by the fact that, I don't know, women are traditionalized now and they would seek help from God and herbs and not from hospitals, but is completely opposed to that. Hospitals can't provide that much help because of the cuts, because of the neoliberalization. You would have to wait like approximately 6 months until you can do a mammography or something like that. So this is just alternative way that women try to find in curing even diseases like cancer. So that is what we are dealing right now, and I would just try not to criticize this as backwards things or something like that, something to do with backwards consciousness or something like that, but to see what were actually so-called structural determinants of these processes and how can we approach them, how can we find bon sense in common sense, and how can we try to make some good politics of all of this. Okay.
Thank you, Andrea. And now we go to Milani Sinanovic, who will present his paper called Repression of Men's Sexuality and Misogyny in Some Modern Islamic Societies. So, Milani, the floor is yours.
Thank you. That was just a working title. Okay. Now it doesn't have any title.
Yes, I forgot I said anything.
I have to wait a little bit for my computer to turn on.
That's also.
I thought there were big questions for her, so I think.
Don't more and accelerate.
Better for them.
I did.
Now it is open. Okay, I'm starting. Islam and capital are completely different organizational principles. They differ.
So, what's up?
Incredible. No, it's for you. Okay, now it works. I think. Islam and capitalism have completely different organizational principles. They differ even on the fundamental ontology. They differ in their understandings of time and space. In Islam, we find two different understandings of time. One is time of hell, which is a time of eternal return of the bad events. The other is time of heavens, which is actually a non-time, a pure duration. Time of capitalism is a linear time, time which is measured and rationalized. This is the working time, which is, as Marx showed, a core element of surplus value. Quran is a text which denies such a linear time again and again. As its time organization is different, its ontological perspective is, and therefore its social, economic, and political principles can coincide with capitalist society, economy, and politics. In Islam, for example, we can find teleology. Therefore, there cannot be such a thing as Islamic culture. Quran is significantly a countercultural text. Nowhere does it forget the historical circumstances in which it was revealed. It is full of direct historical references on struggles of the first Muslims. But it also tends to overcome these historical circumstances and understands itself as being for all times. It is a great reformist text, but it isn't satisfied with reforming being made once for all. It tends towards permanent reforming. It is in this way that it can be signified as a countercultural. On the other point, it is not revolutionary because it is not teleological. Precisely because it is not revolutionary, it managed to cause maybe the greatest cultural revolution in history. Revolution, as we understand it, is an event in a chain of events in linear time, and from this event on, there cannot be a reasonable change. Radical reformism of Quran doesn't have this limit of desire for change. Desire for change is not projected into the future, but is concentrated in any given moment on the surface of history, which is in whole included in that moment and not distributed in a chain of events. Event is already there, one must just grab it. In the first phases, Muslims invented many arts, art forms, scientific disciplines and concepts. And in the first phase of its spread, Islam radically transformed quite a large part of the world. There is also a period of Islamic history known in the West as the Golden Age of Islam. But speaking of a golden age implies kind of a reverted theology. From the point of view of Islam, we can't speak of a golden age. Thomas Bauer indeed tried to prove this in his excellent book, The Culture of Ambiguity. He said that we can find a continuum of the great civilizational achievements and social organization in Islamic world from 19th to 19th century, and that period from 8th to 13th century, which is considered the golden age, isn't a discontinuity. Today, I'm going to talk about the position of women in some part of Islamic world. I myself was raised in a religious Islamic family. My grandfather was an Islamic priest. But this family is of a Bosniak ethnicity, and as we probably already know, cultural habits of Muslims in Balkans doesn't have much in common with cultural habits of Muslims, let's say, in northern Africa or in Iran. And this confession isn't meant to be dismissive to people living on that part of the world or to be apologetic of myself in any way. I'm just stressing an interesting situation we have here. In this context, you can deduce that I do not speak from a personal experience, nor will I try to justify my thesis presented today in a quite an informal fashion with much empirical evidence. With some knowledge in Islamic philosophy, with some interpretation of Quran, with some historical knowledge of the effects of implementing capitalism through colonialization in the late 19th century, and some knowledge of interesting demographical trends on the same area in the last few decades, which are the results of trends of global capitalism in the same time span, I will just try to make an outline for possible further analysis and to question some deeply buried commonsensical and inadequate stances we have on the topic of misogyny in Islamic world. Let us now look this reformism, how this reformism, which I mentioned, works on discursive level in the Quran. Let us check this on the topic of position of women. In the time and space when Islam came to life, there was a rule that men can marry unlimited number of wives and have not an emotional nor economical obligations toward his wives. But Islam started to burst. Muslims were recognized as a danger to existing social order and persecuted. Battles happened. A lot of men were lost on Muslim side. On this point, we should stress that women also battle alongside men, but there were more casualties on men's side for obvious reasons. Women who were left without husbands didn't have the means to earn for a living. Many orphans, many female orphans were treated bad. So because of this, the demographic asymmetry, Quran allowed men to marry few wives, but it limited the number of wives to 4. And there were also conditions. If men couldn't provide economically for all the wives in the same measure, and if he couldn't treat them all equal on the emotional level, he should get rid of the idea of polygamy. There, the decision is put on an individual. But what is most interesting, further in the surah we can read, you should never be able to do justice among women, no matter how much you desire to do so. This is from 4th surah, 129th verse. Some would say there is a contradiction. and they would be right. But as popular interpreter of Quran, Ziauddin Sarda says, the contradictions in Quran are meant to be productive. The final goal should be to get the conclusion that polygamy isn't ethical through use of reason. Some leftists would say that it is, and others would say that any kind of ethics is necessary reactionary, but I beg to differ on that point and leave the analysis of these questions for other occasions. What we are witnessing here is a logic which is completely on terms with the mentioned ontological perspective in Quran, which I presented earlier. Because there is no linear time, the succession of events, all events are put on the surface. There is an allowance of asymmetrical polygamy, but there is also a ban of it. We can only understand this coexistence if we understand this ontological nature of the whole. Permanent reformism is therefore put in this kind of a way that Quran is simultaneously reforming itself through itself. Let us now check what other changes Islam brought in regards of women. In 81st surah, Quran make a critique of a female infanticide. In pre-Islamic Arabia, it was often a shame to give a birth to a girl and baby girls would be buried alive. I will now read the first part of this 81st surah. When the sun is turned into a sphere wrapped up, and when the stars lose their light, and when the mountains are blown, and when pregnant camels are neglected, and when the wild beasts are gathered, and when the seas are boiled, and when the souls are paired, and when the girl buried alive is asked for what sin she was killed, and when the pages are published, and when the sky is stripped off, and when the hell is made ravenous, and when the paradise is brought near, then a soul knows what it has brought forth. After this, the infanticide was banned. Islam also encouraged women to get a religious education. Muhammad's first wife was actually older than him and provided for him who was kind of poor. Islam itself promoted the employment of women. Some scholars quote following verses as the proof of it. As when we came to the water of Majan, he found on it a group of men watering, and he found beside them two women keeping back their flocks. He said, "What is the matter with you?" They say, "We cannot water until the shepherds take away their sheep from the water, and our father is a very old man." This is from 28 Surah, 23rd verse. Women were finally allowed to inherit the property. Quote, "For man is a share from what the parents and near relatives leave, and for woman is a share from what the parents and near relative leave from less from it or more a legal share." This is from 4th Surah, 7th verse. They were also allowed to witness in the courts. The role of men in witnessing was usually more emphasized, but Muhammad himself preferred women witnessing in some matters. Yes, there are some Quranic verses about the position of women which sound quite traditional and patriarchal, no more than there are in the Bible. But the mentioned spirit of radical reformist view towards the issue is the core. Those were some reforms which improved the status of women. Bauer, whom I mentioned earlier, dedicated his book, which I also mentioned earlier, to show us how much these contradictions were presented in the centuries of Islamic civilization and how much were they productive. He showed us examples of coexisting contradictionary law interpretation of the same act, of different coexisting schools for reading the Quran, of deliberately cultivated art of ambiguity in the letters and linguistics. Very early Arabs already had few of their Raymond Queneaus. We know the homosexual poetry was coming from the Islamic world in the Middle Ages. As for the sex life, Ibn Arabi, one of the most prominent thinkers in Islamic history who lived in 9th, 12th and 13th century said, "The most intense and perfect contemplation of God is through women, and the most intense union is the conjugal act." Can we find such a quote, for example, in the mainstream Christian tradition? So, this way of thinking, this permanent reforming, this positive, this surface conception of history and space, without the rigorous limiting of ambiguity, was characteristic of nations under Islam also later, after the first Islamic society for centuries. These were the times of a permanent counterculture. Today, we often hear that Muslims are taking back us back to the Middle Ages. This is an example of sheer inadequate look on the history of Islam, presupposing the linear progress. Bauer writes, let us take the very controversial example. During the ruling of Taliban in Afghanistan, we constantly read and listened in the media that Taliban wished to take Afghanistan back to the Middle Ages, where there was supposedly the stoning of the adulterers and the prohibition of music. But actually, in that time, which Europe calls the Middle Ages, in towns Balkh and Harz, the music wasn't prohibited and the adulterers weren't stoned. There existed the law manuals where one paragraph talks about stoning, but its use in practice was limited by a series of other regulations. Expert law opinion, which prohibited music, was contested with even more expert opinions, which were declaring music as God-pleasing. This, the transition of this part of text was made by me from Slovenia. What happened from then? How did they come to Taliban's rigorous regulation of everyday life, which we see today in some modern Islamic societies? Well, a part of Islamic world started to get integrated in the global capitalist market through colonialization. Nietzsche wrote in his Genealogy of Morals about the connection between memory, theological understanding of history, debt, and the market. If market is to exist, there has to be a memory of given promises, memory of the debts. To create a memory, mnemotechnics for consolidation of memory, there has to be violence. At first, the violence of cruel physical punishment, and later, the self-induced violence of memory and bad consciousness. The surface of history become a depth of memory, depth of time, a vision of progress of humankind. I think that we can say that capitalism drove this ontological set of beliefs and techniques of subjectivation to its edge and spread it around the globe. When it spread it to Islamic societies, this society suddenly lose its core, its non-linear conception of history. They became obsessed with the first cause, with the source. One of the consequences is Salafist worldview, which thinks it is compatible with the lifestyle of first three generations of Muslims. The joy of ambiguity, the gay sciences of Muslim world were destroyed. Obsession with the non-ambiguity came, an aggressive demand for clear answers became a rule. Muslims started to hate their past, full of ambiguity and relaxed views on topics of sexuality, gender roles and so on. They think they are being ruled because they are trailing in comparison with the colonizers. So the ruling class in Islamic society starts to embrace this worldview. Bauer notices the conservatism we can see in the modern Islamic world is a consequence of embracing the hegemonic Victorian morals of colonizers of 19th century. Following Bauer, there is a constant non-synchronicity between cultures and classes. First, the ruling classes in Islamic world adopt the worldview of the colonizers. Then colonizers move on, change their worldview, and then dominated class in Islamic world adopted worldview of their ruling classes, therefore now former worldview of the colonizers, and so on. Muslim world is caged in this permanent trailing. It becomes subjected to a constant view of the other, of the West. It is always in depth towards the West. It is fully integrated in teleological conception of history. Conservative reaction stops the permanent reforming which I talked about. There can be just a limited set of rules regarding different topics. Muslim men, for example, can marry up to four women no matter the circumstances and so on. Colonialization includes a large part of Muslim world to uncertainties of capitalist regime. Economic growth in the middle of the past century provided a change chance for implementation of more social-friendly politics. It caused a population explosion in the region. Calculations say that 65% of population in the Arab world is under the age of 30. In 1966, the population of Egypt was around 30 million. In 2008, it was around 79 million. Between 1930 to 2005, the population of Pakistan grew from 23 million to 160 million people. And since 1945, population of Afghanistan grew from 8 to 30 million. The consequences are evident. It is very hard to provide work for such a big mass of young people, especially in a developing capitalist economy. The combination of economic and demographic catastrophe is, of course, even bigger when recession happens, such as it happened in the late 2000s. What does that mean for position of women? We have already said a few times that integration in capitalist economy switched the understanding of history to linear conception, when there can be no ambivalences in law, habits, and values on the surface of possibilities. Everything gets oriented towards a phantasmatic historical source, and therefore desurfacization, this is hierarchization, starts. And the model for this hierarchization are the moral coordinates of 19th century colonizers. As a model of permanent reformism is stopped, as tradition compass for orientation in time is forgotten, the adaptation to new circumstances can hardly be rational. So what happens when traditional laws are rigorously adopted in this situation? Men can still marry for women. Men can only marry if they can economically provide for women. It is prohibited to have premarital sex. Well, now only rich men can marry. Only older brothers have educational possibilities and possibilities for jobs, so only they can have wives and have sex. Some of them can have more wives and have even more sex. Because they are respectful members of society, their sexual rights for their women can be questioned. Also, the adultery is severely punished. Married women become untouchable. They are slowly moved to a category of sacred. Strange kind of respect is cherished towards married women, especially mothers. Because men can marry few wives, there is non-proportional number of women left for a possible marriage. This is the point that clearly shows an irrationality of a fixation on a bad phantasm of historical source of Islam. As we explained, the asymmetrical polygamy in first Islamic society served as a means for productive regulation of a demographic deformation, as a lot of men were killed in battles. Now this rule is causing already deformed demographics even more damage. So some women are untouchable and sex becomes a taboo theme. When we Google a little, we find a few of the very popular conservative Islamist websites where imams are giving advices to believers. There you can find elements of sexual frustration of young Muslim men. They ask imams if they can masturbate. Imams strictly prohibit this sexual practice. The ruling is that they cannot have any kind of sexual life, or that they can have any kind of sexual life only if they can get married. But they can't get married because they have no money. So men don't know anything about sex, they don't know how to flirt with women because they can't practice, they have a strange Hitchcockish respect toward their mothers, they can't masturbate. You can imagine how much sexual frustration that causes. Statistics show that most visitors of porn websites come from the Islamic countries, despite the effort put in censorships of this kind of sites in some of these countries. Following is the list of 10 countries by number of searches with the word sex in Google from 1st to 10th. Pakistan, Egypt, Iran, Vietnam, India, Indonesia, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Poland, and Romania. 6 of 10 countries have predominantly Muslim population. I remember when Literary Magazine, where I am currently an editor, published a short story of a young writer from Algeria. The story had a title that perfectly suits my explanation. The title was "Jobless Sitting in a Popular Cafe in Times of Sexual Frustration." The story was pretty much about watching women passing by and fantasizing about them from the perspective of an unemployed young man. So, on the one side, we have a protection of married women and mothers who are considered sacred. We have a dark, phantasmagoric world of countless, of completely sexually deprived, sexually inexperienced and humiliated young men who can't get a job. Any kind of job. And there we have women who try to emancipate themselves from the role of mothers, women who from one reason or another aren't married yet. We have popular stars from the West, and we have a lot of female tourists from the West. These are exactly the women who didn't enter the category of sacred and are the targets of this immense sexual frustration, which causes great hostility towards them. There are millions of young men for which the economic perspective of having a satisfying sexual life and after the unrest in recent years, a perspective of having, of even having a safe life on the most basic level is non-existing. We can say that it is actually surprisingly how little number of criminal acts, including asexual offenses, were committed from the side of young immigrants to Europe. And we can confirm that we have a situation which is ideal for creating an atmosphere for misogyny. And we have also, we can also say that religion played an important role in creating this atmosphere. But this is, as I showed, a kind of religion without its core ontology, and Islam without Islam. This Islam without Islam is intellectually non-productive, it is politically non-productive. If Islam managed to cause intellectual, cultural, and social revolutions in the past, it was precisely because of its ontological perspective, which it is now deprived of, and it is in a state of a permanent, and its former state of permanent reforming. We can conclude that there are three crucial ways in which capitalism shaped the misogynic stances in some other Islamic society. First, with implementing its views on time, space, organization of production, rationality. Second, with a phase of welfare which was only possible in a limited span of time and which offered the possibilities for a baby boom. And third, with an economic crisis. Therefore, it is a time to paraphrase Horkheimer once again. Whoever is not prepared to talk about capitalism should remain silent also about Islamism and misogyny in a part of Islamic world. We therefore agree with an average European racist that this religious formation can be aggressive, misogynic and anti-intellectual. But an average European racist doesn't know anything about Islamic history, about Islamic philosophy and ontological dimensions of Quran. Actually, he's also aggressive, misogynic and anti-intellectual. Therefore, we have quite a dangerous situation, and we can say that there is actually a kind of clash of civilizations. But this view, no matter how adequate it can be, is only a generalized view. Worst thing we can do as kind of intellectuals is to forget the internal differences on both sides. There are also liberals among Arabs, there are also classes among them. People coming from different habituses have different views on religion, different views on the role of the women. There are internal ideological battles between them. We assigned that when we are talking about sexual privilege people. We also didn't consider the differences in law in different countries. When speaking on that kind of controversial topic, we must not forget on details. When we start to talk only in general terms, we necessarily step on non-educated or half-educated and aggressive stance of masses from one or the other side. We become part of the problem. I'm in fear that some most famous leftist intellectuals have already made this mistake. So let me propose a very boring maxim. No matter how much the situation is unfortunate, the analysis must not stop. I hope my paper today managed to provide one of bare possible starting points for further analysis. Thank you.
Thank you, Moanis, and thank you, Andrea, again. So if there are any questions on their papers or contributions, you can hand, and Sasha and Nika will give you the microphone. Okay, if not, then I will, as per normal, start with a question. I will have maybe one for Andrea, but I think also Moanis, you can find a way to answer it. Your let's say approach on how to perceive women that are part of religious practices, you know, particularly in Serbia, and how to actually think of them as rational subjects who know, like, who have a reflection on their own position and have a critical opinion towards the, let's say, religious practices that are imposed on them and imposed on their role as women. Would you find that also a useful approach when it comes to the, let's say, Western approach towards Muslim women, who I believe are a lot of times put into this position as
being just the oppressed part of society with no knowledge of their oppression, and that the Western intervention will be here just as someone who will show them how oppressed they are and show them what is to be a free woman in the Western society, while on the other hand ignoring its own oppressive elements in the West, and also, yes, in a way, but still in a way try to point out the problematic aspects of, let's say, maybe Islam. So what would you say, is that something that can be used in this way, or?
Yeah, well, I completely agree with you. I mean, that was actually the guideline for me doing this subject, and not only Muslim women. I believe that any, how to say, oppressed group should be analyzed and with this methodology. So yes, I would agree, but I would also say I was translating for Le Monde Diplomatique in Serbian edition, many texts from different Muslim women actually criticizing this West approach. And yes, one of them said, I cannot remember her name, but it was something like, even I have no idea of experience of those women from lower classes, and how could so I don't want to fall into some kind of essentialism or something like that, but we really need to take all these factors into our perspective when we're dealing with these questions. One of those were they were very critical about what's the name of those stupid Pussy Riot or Famine, or I don't know, two girls that are getting naked all the time. And yeah, and they were like, if patriarchy in the Muslim world is for them to be, for women to be closed, completely dressed all the time, for Western patriarchy, we can talk about being them undressed all the time. So how is that progressive?
Yeah, this is a good point. I want to say that I stressed the man gaze of women. I stressed the women question through a gaze of a man, because in patriarchal society, the woman body is the core of the question. The visibility of woman body is regulated in that or the other way. So I wanted to stress that it is also the same, but in a different, let's say, practical implementation in the West. We still live in a patriarchal society, as far as we know. As long as there is a question of visibility of woman body, we are in a patriarchal society. But analyzing the position of women in modern Islamic world, it would I would have to write another topic, or I wouldn't even do this, because I would leave that to a Muslim female. I don't consider myself being a...
I have a few questions. First of all, for Andrea, there's a really, really good book called Everyday Religion, written by Samuel Schulke. I think you should be very interested for you. The question of piety comes to mind, is that this is something that I missed with both of you, is what it means to be a good Muslim and what it means to be a good Orthodox Christian. Those are really interesting things and have to do a lot with private versus public, because I know Muslims in West Africa that during Ramadan they they fast when they're in front of their parents, kind of, and then when they go out they would hide into bars and drink beers, and then would have all this discussion, is this good or is this bad, and things like that. So it's, I think this private versus public is very interesting, because it also tells you how people are interpreting religion and how they think a good religious person should live, and also how these dogmas from official structures of religious come and things like that. The other thing is this age sets and category of youth that Moanis was talking about, young Muslim men not being able to marry, I think that's very interesting because it's occurring everywhere right now, because you have these age sets and rites of passage where this category of youth never existed. You were a child and then you were a man, and when you're a man you can marry. So now there's a whole bunch of people that are just stuck in this liminal space that never ends, which is also something very interesting. That my comment.
When it comes to the question about what is good Orthodox Christian, there are two different answers, because there are two genders, if we listen to this approach. So if you want to be a good Orthodox Christian man, well, you will have to be, you know, father of the family, the main person in the family. You have to work and to provide goods for this family, and but you would also have to be you would have to be religious. You shouldn't. There are different kind of a moral stance that this also includes, like not cheat, not steal, not and so on. And it is, but responsibility is the main thing, and doing public work, and that is something that it is not included when you're talking about what is a good Orthodox Christian woman, because it's supposed to be in the house, of course, to be housewife, to be a mother, to not engage in sex, but this is both for the both gender. So, I don't know, but until they get married, and to be just a humble person, I don't know, and not to intervene in public manners. That's one of the. But it is interesting that they are actually, it did evolve through the last century, and we do have some like. And it's similar to the Muslim world, some engagements in like women should educate themselves in theology or into religious issues, even in faculties. So, yeah.
Well, as for myself, I found the idea of judging who is good, or Muslim or not, quite disgusting. I don't give any recognition of any institution who allows itself to do this kind of things, but it is quite a problem to talk about what a good Muslim means in different parts of the world, because Muslims didn't have that kind of widespread or universal institution as Catholic churches. When Islam was spreading, it always came to touch with local customs, and it like accumulated social and capital and so on of these customs. Islam is very different. Islam is a religion of 1 per 5 billion people, and if there is any kind of unification, it is precisely because of the colonization. I don't want to be this boring liberal who is talking about white guilt and so on, but historically speaking, white guilt actually exists, and it is very deep. So white people united Muslims around the world, and in few ways. So I guess the answer, because of that answer, would be kind of a similar, if I tried to generalize to that of Andreas about good Christians.
We have a question from Josipa.
Yes, it's about the 2011 uprisings, and if you think that those uprisings were about kind of sexual liberation, or those people going to the street, going to the square, were asking for more sexual rights, for instance, women.
I'm not very familiar with that situation. I don't know what happened. with sexual questions in that time, but I heard from my friends who traveled around Turkey that kind of a sexual revolution is part of the protest against Erdogan in Turkey at that moment. This is all I can say. Friends said to me that they are going to kind of a 68, actually. The Kurds are there Vietnamese, you know. And the sexual question is part of that whole, let's say, progressive, liberal, hippie worldview that is currently going on in Turkey. But I was quoting Bauer constantly. He said that different classes of Muslim Islamic society are like lagging in history. They are adopting the views of Western society like generations after the view after the which after the first after the original views happened then. And I think this kind of spirit among young people in Turkey is proof of that, like, historical rule about lagging in history. We'll see what will happen in the future. I think the future is going to be very interesting because Islam will be the largest world religion in like few decades, and it will have a lot of geopolitical power, so it is going to be very interesting. I will going to look about it. This is all I can say.
Yeah, okay, the obvious add-on to that your response. I mean, it's, I guess, empirically true about this lagging in this current case, but can you really generalize this? Isn't it more of a, well, being a, the situation repeats because, let's say, that the mode of the authority to which they are rebelling is, let's say, in a sense, similar or relatively similar to what was the mode of authority in the West before the sexual revolution, before the 68 rebellion. So it's more of a, it's not like, you know, historical, necessary historical development where everything happens in Islam 50 years later, but just currently there is, you know, in a sort of non-theological way.
Yeah, of course, yeah. I agree totally.